So before I begin the session, I'd like to thank the organizers, especially Naresh. He has been really very helpful, and he has arranged a wonderful event. And I hope we all are learning a lot, and especially the people sitting here as well as the presenters are learning a lot from you all. And so I hope that during my presentation, I'll also be learning a lot from you all. And hopefully you will also get to learn something from me. So let's start with some information about me. I am Md Aman Khan. I work as a front-end developer in Applied Research Works. It is basically a health-related company. It stores information related to patients and doctors and the performance of different doctors, helps the payers, the insurance companies with the information, and it helps the doctors to find out information about the patients to take care of them. And also does a lot of visualizations of those informations. So basically, before we started using D3, we were doing visualizations using high charts and Tableau. We were experimenting with Google charts and high stocks also. We were not working till before 6 months with D3. We had no information what D3 is or how powerful it is. But then I was asked to do some information, some experimentation regarding the other libraries that are present which can do wonderful visualizations. So before we go into that, we'll have to understand what big data actually is and why visualization is that important and how visualization can actually help us or in some places, in some scenarios, actually harm us. So we are basically living in a scenario where we have too much information given to us. But this too much information, the word too much is something which is relative. Till a few days back, information that was actually not that much that we have right now seemed to be too much to us. But right now we have, the processors have become very much powerful. We have more storage spaces and we have much more processing speed. The internet speed is getting better, especially in India. And so the information which was actually too much a few years before is not actually that much right now. So during this presentation, I'll be touching aspects about big data, what actually it means and what are the different categories of big data that we have right now. We'll also be focusing on the different types of visualizations that are there. We'll try to figure out the different characteristics that are present in the different data by which we can identify which particular type of visualization we should use for that particular data. We'll be covering the different types of visualizations that are there and especially that can be used to visualize using D3. And then we'll be trying to learn about the different phases that D3 itself provides us, the kind of data binding it actually does to the DOM elements and how we can use that in our benefit and use that to visualize the different data. And we'll also be going through a different series of demos that we have actually visualized in our website. We'll be covering different visualizations related to the healthcare data that we had at hand. We'll be using test data for that. We'll not be actually showing the actual data, but we'll be showing the different visualizations that are out there. So regarding big data, visualization of data is not something that we have recently started. Even before we had computers, even before we had processing speed, even before we had animations out there, visualization of data used to take place. Even the tables that we use, they're actually a visualization of the data that we have in hand, and we are trying to figure out what information we have. So even that is a kind of visualization, but all types of visualizations have their pros and cons. And there might be scenarios where actually the table, the actual visualization that existed in those days were actually better than the visualization that we have right now. Because when we add too much information to that particular data, we might end up abstracting information that could have been present in that layout, the simpler layout that is there in the table. So right here that we can see in this small span is a table. It was there in the early 19th century. They started actually keeping a track of tables of health of different people who were dying and tried to figure out how many people were dying out of plague. But in later on, as time processed in the early 20th century or so, this visualization actually got better and they started using a polar diagram in which the area was being used to identify the types of deaths. And there were different categories of deaths. The deaths were actually taking place because of accidents. They were actually taking place because of plagues or different in different manners. But this visualization was not dynamic Like if we wanted to see a particular time frame of information, it was not possible to see. But it was still a visualization which conveyed more information that was actually already existing there. And before we had animation, this visualization seemed the best possible way to show that particular data. However, as time progressed in 2011, we represented this exact data in a different way. This is a particular representation that I found online of that particular visualization, and we can see the different types of deaths that was taking place throughout the year. And this is the time frame of that particular visualization. And we can see that the reds are actually the deaths that were taking place because of wounds. The blacks are actually deaths which we do not know the causes for. And the blue are because of preventable causes which could have actually been prevented. And if we just continue with the time frame, we can actually see this effect. So if we want to see the death visualization for a particular month, or we want to see how the death is actually going on, we can see that in January the amount of deaths taking place were a lot and they could have actually been prevented. So we get more information that we are actually getting in that static representation that already existed, and definitely much more information that we are getting via a particular static table. Similarly, if we see visualization of weather out there, before animations and everything existed, we used to visualize the weather using static maps out there. But these static maps were not able to convey the weather changes or weather patterns that were taking place throughout the seasons. And if they wanted to convey it, they'll have to create multiple weather maps and distribute it to other people. And that would be really a very cumbersome process. But as time moved on and processing speed and the resources that we have at hand, the technologies improved, we have created visualizations of weather which are actually much more robust and much more informative than the visualization that already existed. Similarly, here we have a visualization of evolution that we have at hand. Initially, we used to, when we used to study in schools, we used to see evolutions represented in the form of static pictures. And all the trees, whether the ancestry is belonging to reptiles or whether it is belonging to birds, were represented using those static visualizations out there. But right now, with so much technology that we have at hand, these visualizations have actually improved, and we can actually show a lot more information that we are able to before using these different types of technologies and visualizations that are out there. And now coming to big data, one very good example of big data is representing the whole internet connections out there that we have at hand. The internet itself is a world which is separate. Then our world, we have people, we have representations of ourselves out there, representation of perhaps people would not exist. And that itself is a world, and if we want to represent that world, it is something of a very big challenge. It is, if we try to visualize it, it will look like a universe to us. And this is exactly how it looks like. And this is a very good example of representing big data. Now, if these types of visualizations are what we want to portray, and we want to portray it in such a manner that we can get the characteristics out of it which we are actually intend to, then conventional ways of representing it in the form of charts or in the form of static diagrams will not be enough. And especially if we want to represent it just in the form of tables, then it will not make any sense at all. And if data that we have at hand does not make sense to us, it is as good as having no data, except for the fact that we can perhaps sell that data to someone else who can make sense of it. But it won't be making that much of benefit to us, that much of help to us, as it could have had it made a bit of sense. So with that, we try to understand what a good visualization and bad visualization actually is. On the left side, we have a visualization of the densities of fish out there in the sea for different decades and centuries. In 1900, the density, as we can see out there, was quite large of fish. But in 2000, the density has reduced a lot. So if this is the information that we are actually looking for, the density out there in the different seas that we want to figure out, then this is a very good visualization. We can see that the areas that are yellow are quite dense, and the blue ones are not that dense. And in 2000, we can see that the densities are actually almost missing out there. So we can make sense of it, and we can get a lot of information of it. We can find out which regions are actually having the densities of fish and whether they have reduced or not. But if we see the visualization here, which is representing the number of features that Microsoft Word, different versions of Microsoft Word had presented to us, then we'll be able to see a pie chart which does a comparison of the different features. But there is a lot of other data associated with that feature. For example, those features are not actually features which were given to us in the same timeline. They were not given to us in the same period. So the information regarding the period of that feature is missing. Also, the information regarding the actual number of features that were provided or the actual features that were provided is missing. And especially the 3D look of this chart does not give any relevant or more information to us than it would have had it just been a 2D chart. So this is not that good a visualization. So this is very important that if we are trying to visualize something and if we choose the wrong type of visualization for it and we end up hiding information which actually made much more sense to the user, then it is as good as not having that visualization. Here is a basic flowchart to understand what all factors that we should keep in mind when we are trying to choose a particular visualization. For example, if the type of data is continuous and it is changing with time and it has a lot of periods and we are trying to compare the actual differences between the different series that we have at hand, the absolute differences, then we can choose a stacked layout for that visualization. Then we'll be able to compare the absolute values between the different series, and we'll also be able to compare the relative components that are present in that particular series. We'll be able to make sense of it. However, if that particular series is too large and it is continuous and it is too much, then if we are actually trying to visualize it, and this, the number of attributes that are there are single, then a single line chart would have been enough. However, if the data is not continuous and it is discrete, and if we do not have too much information at hand, then we should not use a continuous line chart. Just bars that we have out here are enough to actually understand that visualization. And if you are trying to visualize a particular series which is actually circular in nature, for example, the one which we visualized in the previous slide, the one which had deaths taking place in different seasons, and it actually comes back to January, we should use a spiral visualization which actually gives us the interpretation of the cyclic nature of the data. And if we have a third variable attached to the series, if we have X, Y, and a Z attached to the series, the data, then we should use that, we should try to visualize that data using the different radiuses that we can give through the bubbles out here. So these are the different types of visualizations. We have the different types of visualizations here also, like if we are trying to visualize a series which has actually two variables involved and they are discrete in nature, then we can use a bar chart out there. But if we are trying to visualize a data which has only a single variable and we do not need to compare two series, then we can simply use a bar chart. If we are trying to find out the different components that are present in the overall data that exists, then we can use a simple pie chart out there. If we are trying to compare a time series of the different information that exists, then we can use a line chart and we can do a comparison of those different series that are existing out there and we can get a lot of information for it. But if the same data that we need to present is actually not that discrete in nature and we need to do a comparison of the time, then we can use a continuous line chart for it. Scattered chart is used to understand a time distribution of the information that is present at hand. And if that particular scatter chart wants another dimension added to it, we can use a bubble chart for it. A 3D chart is used to understand a distribution which has actually more than two attributes associated with it, and we can use that 3D area to identify the distribution which are actually taking place in the X, Y, as well as the Z axis. Stacked area is something which I've already discussed, and the waterfall visualization is something which we use when we are actually trying to understand whether there has been an increase in the data available or there has been a decrease. And it is used when the nature of the time is discrete in nature and we can actually understand something from it. These are two visualizations that we have actually used in our website. These are advanced visualizations, and one of it is a spiral Sankey chart. A Sankey chart is basically a visualization where the width of the data represents the amount of flow that is coming out of it, and it is dynamic in nature. And it is spiral. It can actually be used to represent network flows or some other things. Right? For in our case, we have used the circular Spanky chart because it makes sense. We'll come to know why when we actually discuss that particular visualization. And we had actually drilled down that particular visualization to do a network chart in which we tried to understand relationships between two particular nodes of doctors, and the lens actually represented the patients that were interacting with the different doctors. And we'll talk about it more when we actually go through the demos. Coming to D3, when we're actually working with TabView and high charts and other technologies out there, other visualization related technologies out there, we were actually facing one problem. High charts, Google charts, and other visualizations out there were not able to render the large amount of data that we had in an efficient manner. And TabView had its drawbacks. The drawback that TabView was giving us actually was the customization of the visualization that we had was not that easy. And the rendering of the data was not that smooth. The animations that we wanted to be present in that data to understand how the data is actually changing was not that smooth. And we had less control over the data because TabView actually, we have to export that data in their server. We had to export that data in their server, and then we had to do filtering out there. And even for visualizations which were not that complex, it was taking a lot of time to actually get that visualization, even if the amount of data presented in the chart was very small. So while going with D3, we were trying to compare different charts, the pros and cons that were associated with the different visualizations. And the only con that we figured out D3 had is that it required a lot of programmatic knowledge. And for a developer who's actually working in the front end, that is not that much of a big challenge. If he's willing to put that effort to get a effective visualization and an impressive visualization. And the main difference between D3 and other visualization tools out there was that D3 actually attaches. It has a concept of attaching data to DOM elements out there. You will not be actually just visualizing data, but you will be associating data with particular sections, particular boxes out there, particular divisions out there, and then you visualizing data, irrespective of what that data that is attached to that particular DOM. You do not need to figure out how many bars you need or whether the radius of the particular element has to be big or small. It will only be based on the data that is associated with that particular element. This is what something, this feature is something that was not present in high charts or Google charts, because there we had to actually understand the data on ourselves and we had to manipulate that data to figure out what we need to do with it. And another main advantage that D3 is providing us is that it provides us a lot of existing templates out there. There are a lot of examples out there. If you just go through the d3.org site, you'll find thousands of examples out there and thousands of templates which are already existing. D3 does not provide templates in which you can actually just pass the data and it will give you a visualization. A bit of programming is required to get the visualization that you want. But there are already existing codes out there which you can just reuse it and just manipulate it a bit to get the effect that you want, and it will be good enough. For example, the cord chart, the network chart that we are using, we had to do very minimal changes to the existing codes that were out there to get the visualizations that we actually wanted. Now to understand D3 phases, what D3 actually does is that when we try to attach data to some particular element, it creates an empty stack of that particular division. And it pushes all the data that we want associated with it to that particular stack. Let us see an example out there where the data was actually 4, 8, 15, 16, and 23, and a portion of it is missing. 23 and 42, and what it actually did here, if we go through the code here, is that in this section, we are actually trying to enter the data that we want to associate with the particular element. What we did is we did a chart.selectAll on dot bars. Now, what this is do, what? You cannot see that, right? Can you see it now? What we are actually doing is that we are creating an empty container. Initially, this class did not exist. So what it will do is that it will not select anything. It will just create an empty container out there. And then when we are trying to push that particular data, it will put all the data that is there in the variable in the form of a stack. And then it will append it to that container, and then whatever we want to do with it, whether we want to associate it a rectangle or attach a rectangle or a circle with it, it will do that. So this is the portion in which we are actually attaching or entering that particular data. This is the portion in which we are actually updating that particular data. In this section, the rectangles will already be attached. And if there are 6 datas that we are adding in that particular element, if we are entering 6 datas, then there will be 6 rectangles that will be created in that particular division after we are running this particular portion of the code. But they will not have any attributes associated with it. They will not have any positions associated with it. They will not have any width associated with it. So you'll not be able to see anything on screen. But this is the portion which actually gives the attributes to that particular section, the X attribute, the Y attribute to determine the location in which you want to put that data. The height and the width actually gives the dimensions of that particular rectangle. Now this is just a selector. This is something which actually makes us understand that D3 is not just a visualization tool. It is also used for data manipulation and DOM manipulation. So this is exactly like how jQuery selectors work. And when we are using D3 selectors, it provides us more functionalities, like this transition function and duration function. We'll be understanding what those are in a short while. Attributes are very much similar to how jQuery attributes work. They will be associating an X attribute to it, a Y attribute to it, and a height and a width to it. This is something, this D is the data that will be associated with that particular rectangle. Now we have already understood that when we are actually attaching data to it, it is also, along with the rectangles, it is also associating the data that was actually responsible for those rectangles. So when we are trying to update that rectangle later on, it will actually remember which data was associated with which particular rectangle or which particular figure. And then when we are trying to use a function d, i, the d represents the data that is associated, and the I represents the index of the data based on the original array that I had passed when I was entering that data. And using this d and I, we can actually pass this particular values to different functions, and if we want that X to be dependent on some other function or the transformation function, we can do that. Here I'm using an X function, which is actually a scale. We'll be understanding what scales are also recently in a short while. And then we are giving a height to it and a width to it. The width is constant for all the bars, and they're actually, I'm just dividing the whole section of the width into different, based on the number of elements that I have, and I'm dividing the whole section into widths, and I'm just representing that as bar width, and I'm giving that width to it. The height is something that will be dependent on the actual value of that particular bar. So that is why I'm using this particular value of D here, where D is actually the value that is associated with that particular rectangle. And X is a scale, which I have used, because when I'm trying to actually giving a value of 43 to that particular rectangle, the actual value 43 may be too small for that particular screen. So we actually want to scale that particular value that we have for that particular rectangle to the whole image that we have in that particular graph. So that is actually done using the D3 scales out there. There are different types of scales. The linear scale actually maps a particular range of data, X to Y, to something else, which is specified in the range. For example, X is mapped to A and Y is mapped to D. And what it does internally is it interpolates the data that is in between X and Y, to the data that is present in between A and B. And the next time you try to call that scale with a particular value, all that you do is actually call that interpolation and get a particular value for that, the value that you are actually calling. And you'll be able to figure out the position. So what we are actually doing here in the X is that we are trying to figure out the index of that particular data that we have at hand, and we are trying to figure out on which which X position we want to put that data, and it is dependent on the order of the data that we have at hand. That is why we are using I. And we have the scale of X that we have is something this. Like we have mapped the number of data that we have at hand, 0 to the number of data that we have at hand. And we have mapped it to 0 to the total width minus bar width of the whole chart. Why did we have to do a minus bar width? Because when we are trying to put a position X to it, it actually starts from these positions. So had we actually used 0 to width in this particular range, and if it had started a bar at the end of the chart, then we'll not be able to see that particular bar out there. So that is why we had to do a minus width out there. And then we used this particular scale to figure out the x indices out there. And then we are using the y scale in a similar manner to figure out the height. And we are using the actual value that is present, that is given to us in the data, to figure out the height of that rectangle. In a similar way, the text is also associated with that particular division. We figure out the position of that text and what the actual text will actually be. And the exit actually removes the data. If we are trying to update that data, after entering some data at a particular time, we want to update that data. The new data might actually be larger than the data that was already present in the number of, respective to the number of data that were there, or it may be smaller than the data that were already there. Now, if initially we had 10 data associated with that particular division, but later on we had only 5 data associated with it, then we will need the exit phase to remove the remaining 5, which are actually extra, to be removed from the visualization. This is actually achieved by using the D3 data exit and remove functions. D3 data exit actually selects the data which need to be exited, which are not actually present in the visualization, but are being shown, and the remove actually removes it from our visualization. So to understand it, we will try to use these functions. The sort descending actually modifies this particular data and sorts this in a descending manner. So when we sorted it, we can see that the height got modified, and now this data is being represented in a descending manner. Now the important thing to understand here is that how did D3 actually understand which bar to alter and modify to give that particular transition? That was because of the nature of the stack that D3 actually follows when we are trying to enter data to it. We'll understand that when we try to exit a particular column. Now here, intentionally, I will be trying to exit the data 23 from this particular visualization. And when I will be removing that data 23, the data 23 will actually not be exited. What will happen is actually 42 will get removed, and 23 will take its place. You can see that here. Now, why did this happen is because of the, as I already said, stack nature, and this is the data that was actually passing when I'm trying to exit this particular visualization. And what it actually does is that 42 comes in place of 23. So this is how D3 understands which data to exit. The first element is 4, second element is 8, third is 15, fourth is 16. Fifth element becomes 42. So the fifth element that we had in our visualization, which was 23, actually that particular bar becomes 42. And the data which actually needs to be exited, the bar that actually needs to be exited, is the remaining portion of that visualization already existing on the chart, which in our case is just 42. So when we exit, the 23 will become 42, and the remaining extra bar that we had out there will get removed. Now that is one thing that we have understood. Now we will be going through transition and duration. Now if we did not have this transition and duration, we have not added transition and duration to the text out there. And when we try to update, you will be able to see a difference. Because we have not added a transition, there is no delay to it, there is no animation to the text that is available, and just in a snap, it is just updated and it is present in the location where it should be. However, we have added a transition and a delay to the updation of the bars out there. So we can see an interpolation of the path and the attributes that needs to be performed to actually go to the end. And 2000 actually means 2 seconds, so it actually signifies the total amount of time that it should take to complete that particular visualization. We can increase that particular amount of time to more than 2000, and we can add there are also other functions associated with transitions out there, such as ease, which actually signifies how will the end of the transition look like. Do you want it to speed up initially, or do you want it to speed up in the end? Do you want it to be linear? Do you want the speed of the transition to be linear throughout? These can also be controlled using D3. Now, this was just a basic animation, a basic visualization that we created. And these types of visualizations can be created not only for bars. They can be created for scatter chart. They can be created for bubble charts. And they are not too difficult to actually code. And there are only three phases that we have to keep in mind, the enter, update, and the exit phase. And the only thing that we need to understand is the stacked nature of the data that we are entering. We could have also passed data to it in the form of objects. And just like I'm passing this array of data, I could have passed an array of objects to it. And instead of calling D, I could have just used that particular variable that I want to associate with that particular object and use what attribute I want to use to actually understand the width, what attribute I actually want to use to understand the height. And we could have used different parameters associated with that object to determine different attributes associated with that visualization. D3 also provides a lot of other features associated with visualization, such as D3.map, by which we can actually convert a particular series of data to some other series of data. If you want to convert a series of objects to just a linear array, or if you want to get rid of particular attributes to it, we can do that. We can sort data using D3.sort, and we can define the function that we want to use for sorting. I have used a sort function here. And what I'm doing is here, had I not used this function A comma B return B minus A, it would have sorted the data in the ascending order. But if we want to use our customized way of sorting the data, then we have to define a function by which it will determine what particular value to use to understand where in which position the data will be. It will always try to figure out whether the data needs to be sorted or not by using this value. If B minus A gives a negative value, then it will understand that the present value is smaller than B. And it will always try to sort the whole data based on ascending value of these attributes. So if it is minus 1, it will understand that the value that I'm trying is lesser than the value that is the next attribute, and it will try to sort based on this particular attribute. This is an example of a D3 layout that is provided to us, where we have to do very minimal manipulation to the existing template. And what it does is actually takes input a matrix, where where the rows define the categories and the columns define the categories that are mapping to each other. And we can see here, when we focus on a particular category, the arc represents the different categories. And the total radius of that arc represents the total data that is associated with that particular total associations that are associated.
Layout, and we are using this. camera maker.
The different edges that are associated with the different. And here, when we are defining the different the force layout,
we are associating the values that we want to present in the nodes in the nodes function, and we are associating the links in the links function. This is something that we are getting using this particular CSV, in which we have actually associated in the form of JSON to different series, time series. One is the time series representing the different nodes, in which we have just the name of that particular attribute and nothing else. And the second thing is the links. We are actually describing the source, the target, and the weightage associated with that particular node. The weightage can be used for determining the length of that link or other things. Here, the length of that link is fixed, as we can see from here. Link distance is 60, so it is fixed. The charge is also fixed. But these can be variable depending on the values that are being passed to that particular data. In this video, we'll try to see the visualizations that have actually implemented in Coziva right now using dummy data. This is internal. This is actually a visualization representing the different referrals that are taking place between different categories, different specializations. We actually had a lot of data, and a lot of doctors were transferring patients from one from themselves to some other doctors, and the doctors had specialties associated with it. Now, if we initially wanted to do this whole visualization in the form of a network graph, there was a lot of data, and we couldn't make sense of that data. So we decided that we'll do it in two phases. The first phases will represent the different interactions that are taking place between the different categories out there. And this is actually that particular visualization where we can see that the maximum referrals that are coming out from are the internal medicine. There's a lot of referrals taking place from internal medicine to radiology. And the primary three categories which are actually doing referrals are internal medicine, family physician, and pediatrics, which is visible from this particular section. We can also see that the number of referrals taking place from internal medicine and family physician is similar. We can see that particular graph. This is actually signifying that the number of referrals taking place from internal medicine to family medicine is of similar nature. And this is the self-referral, the amount of referrals that are taking place from internal medicine to other medicine. This actually represents that there are not much referrals taking place from these particular specializations to the other specializations. Now we'll be selecting a few specialties and try to drill down into the network graph, which will be representing the different referrals that are taking place within the different doctors. We can see the different colors out there. The colors represent the different specializations that are associated with the different doctors. The length, the value on the link actually signifies the number of referrals that are taking place between the different doctors. These are the names of the different doctors associated. We can also drag the whole cluster to somewhere else, and then we can study that particular cluster. Now, in this particular cluster that we can see that these are the doctors, these five doctors are doing referrals among each other, but they are not sending any referrals to someone else. Now, this is something which is very important to understand. We'll be making a lot of sense based on this data, and we'll be able to figure out the relationships between the different doctors based on this visualization. Here we can see that there are only two doctors, and they're passing referrals only between each other, and not to someone else. And we will be seeing another. This graph actually represents the comparison between the risk and utilization of the different different patients and the doctors that we have out there. The first layer represents the PO level, that is the institute or organization level. And we, the x-axis actually represents the risk or the amount of danger the patient is, and the utilization actually represents how much amount of money that patients is actually having to give that for that particular treatment. We can see from here that Hawaii IPA, this is not actually a real based on real data, but just mock data. And here we can see that the patients that are associated with this particular organization have relatively less risk associated with them. But the amount of cost that they are having to pay for is relatively very high. We can try to drill down into a particular level, and then we'll be able to see the doctor view. So here we are representing the different doctors out there. We can see that these two doctors are performing quite well, but this particular doctor is, the risk is less than one, pretty much less than one, and the utilization is very high. So we drill down to that particular doctor to find out the patients who are actually having higher risk but low, lower risk but high utilization, so that we can give suggestions to those doctors to focus on those patients. And these are those, this section actually gives us those patients. So there are quite a few patients out there which have very less risk, but very high utilization. And then we can, using this particular data, suggest to the doctors associated to take care of those particular patients. And this is for one particular quarter, and we can change the quarter also to understand what will be the risk versus cost visualization for some particular, some other time frame. And then we can, by clicking on those particular tabs, drill down, go back to a previous level. And then we can proceed on with the same flow. So along with that, we have also done other visualizations associated. I have not created demos for that, but we have tried to do visualizations of medications out there. What we have done is a patient may be having medications in a for a long time, and there might be cases where actually missing out on medications. So the for the doctor to understand that particular scenario, he has to see a timeline, and he'll be able to see red bars out there in between the different tabs to figure out that if there is a particular time for which the person was not having the medication he was supposed to do. And we have also done a visualization of the vitals that are associated with that particular patient. The vitals means the temperature, the weight, the height that the patient has in a particular encounter, and we record that. And we visualize those particular vitals in the form of line charts. And if a particular vital is beyond the expected range, we show those particular vitals in the form of red color, so that the doctor can usually see and figure out that that particular vital was something which was bad. With that, I would like to come to the end of my presentation. And if you have any questions regarding any particular visualization that I've presented or anything related to D3, please go ahead. Yeah? Yes? Yeah, two things. First of all, the number of DOM elements depend upon the data that you are actually transferring to the client side. So that is why we actually did two phases of visualizations, where the first phase was actually dealing only with categories, and we were allowing drill downs only for a particular number of categories. We cannot visualize the whole data, and if we wanted to visualize the whole data in a particular glance, it wouldn't make much sense also. And the second thing is that for these visualizations, I've used SVG to actually do the visualization so that I can make interactions with that particular element. But if we do not want any interactions associated with that particular element, but we just want the visualization, we can use Canvas. And then the number of DOM elements will be much lesser, right? Yeah, actually, D3 allows a lot of data manipulation with the association charts. It has the map function which I said, that if you pass a particular data that is provided to you, you can actually manipulate it to something else. You can actually sort it. You can actually, if you have an object which has too many attributes associated with it, and if you do not want that attribute, or if you want to manipulate a particular attribute to something else, then you can do it using the d3.map function. And there are, if you have a particular layout of data, if it is in the form of JSON, if it is in the form of CSV, there are a lot of functions out there which actually do that. And in my particular demo for the force layout, I had used the CSV layout. Yes. You can, what you can do is actually combine the visualization that you have in R with some visualization which exists in D3. And all the interactions that you want to associate with that particular data, or if the particular section where we want to, where we want the visualization to look pretty, or actually the visualizations, the transitions to look good, you can use D3 for that visualization. But if there is some static visualization or something which is not that visually important, then you can do it with R, something which requires a lot of processing, and then you can combine those data. Tabus actually provide that. There are examples out there which actually combine Tabu with the visualizations using D3, and the output is really good. And I've heard with my fellow associates in my company that Tabu also will be perhaps in the future doing its own visualizations using with the help of D3. You had a question? The main reason that the whole process of actually visualization becomes complicated if you use D3 is D3 actually does not give the whole by stack. Tabu gives the whole by stack. It provides the place to store the data, manipulation of the data, and it provides the visualization also. So there are tools which are actually doing that. Zoom data is an example of that, something which is similar to Tabu, but does this implementation using D3, and it has something related to the sharpening of data. Like if we are, when we are trying to visualize data which is too big or too huge, what it is actually initially shows is a faded form of that data where nothing is relevant. You can see the visualization, but you cannot actually deal with that particular data. And then as you give it more time, if you give it a few more seconds, the sharpening of the data takes place, and you can manipulate that particular data. So yes, there are tools which are actually using D3 as a library and creating a wrapper library of their own or a wrapper tool of their own and providing things that are there in Tabu. No, but I think there should be. Yeah, you want to communicate where the transition is taking place, right? So the reason that these transitions, when we are actually drilling down a particular element or changing the year, it was slow or there was a loading out there, it wouldn't be had I not communicating. So with every transition that I was actually doing an Ajax, fetching the data that I wanted. And if had I not been doing that, I would have had to associate all the data that is present to the client. An Ajax for it, so I'm communicating with the server side. Anything else? Yeah. Yeah. So basically, if you want to if you want to do some complex visualizations and visualizations of a certain nature which we do not have templates for in Tabu or in HiCharts and Google Charts and all the other charts actually provide us templates. And we can pass that data and they will give the visualization, but that visualization may not be something that we want. And we cannot do actually animations that we want out of it. We cannot do drill downs on that particular, and if we want to do drill down, we'll have to create the whole chart again. We do not have the concept of binding data with particular elements so that when there is a transition, you can see that which particular element is changing to something else. But that is something D3 provides. And what we wanted to do is complex visualizations of big data. If you want to visualize big data with high charts or Google charts, they simply won't work. They take a lot of time to render, and even after rendering, the whole screen lags. But with D3 and attaching the data to the particular DOM, we can see that even complex charts of chords and network layouts and the amount of time that was taken was because of the AJAX call to get the fetch the data. And if we have that data, then the rendering process is really very easy. The interactions are really great, and the user experience is really nice. So when we are trying to change a particular time frame or drill down into a particular visualization, it actually makes sense, which was not making sense for high charts and Google charts. And for Tableau,
like can you just say that I want to add a filter for it and this is what I want to do. But if you want to get a visualization which is customized to your needs, then that is not that easy to do, even in time. That's it. Thank you.